The Ontario Energy Board just approved the construction of the Sault Smart Grid, the largest project of its kind in North America. Nick Dunne covers the Northeast for Ontario Hubs, and he joins us now from Sudbury for more. Hey, Nick.
Hey, Joanne.
All right, so let's start with the basics. What exactly is a smart grid?
Well, let's back that up even further and talk about what the electric grid is. The electric grid is the distribution from the power plant all the way to your home. So those giant transmission lines that go down the highway all the way to those substations, those giant boxes with all the electric wires flying around everywhere to your hydro poles that you see on your street that connect into your house. That is the electric grid, the entirety of that system. A smart grid, on the other hand, is still that system, but it's applying various smart technologies using internet-enabled communication between the meter in your home, components on the grid, you know, various parts of the grid, and across to the central control station of this distribution grid. And basically, using various automation processes and being able to live read energy usage at any given moment, you know, from anyone's home to your largest businesses in town, you can dynamically control and, I guess, make it more efficient through various processes. That's it in a nutshell.
Now, for your article for TVA.org, you're talking about the smart grid in Sault Ste. Marie, but have there been sort of smart grids elsewhere in Ontario?
Yeah, they've definitely been applied in a lot of pilot projects across the GTA. There have been some in Ottawa. I mean, they're quite numerous across Canada, and especially in the United States. You know, there are some very large projects in, you know, Southern California, but what makes the Sault Smart Grid project unique is that they're applying a multitude of different technologies all at once in a fairly compressed time period, about a year, and it's going to be applied to the entirety of its grid. So as a percentage of the utility itself, you know, there are possibly larger projects out there, but relative to its size, it's an incredibly ambitious project.
I think a lot of people are probably going to be asking, why Sault Ste. Marie? Why is this project not being done elsewhere? What is it about the Sault that makes it sort of ideal for this sort of project?
Right. So the city of Sault Ste. Marie in 2008 declared themselves the alternative energy capital of North America. They are a net producer on the grid, and they have some of the largest wind and hydroelectric plants in the province. So they've really invested in this kind of energy, and PUC Utilities, their utility distribution company, is owned by the city. So they've really invested, I guess, to further that branding, I suppose, and invest in their infrastructure to realize some cost savings down the road, not only for them, but for customers as well.
Now, when we talk about the smart grid, do we know how many people this will be serving when we talk about residents and businesses?
This is going to serve the entirety of the customer base, so about 33,000 homes and a whole wide variety of businesses, including Algoma Steel, which is obviously a huge, huge consumer of electricity. You know, melting iron down and processing into steel and producing it requires a ton of energy. So this is going to be across the entirety of the grid.
When we talk about, you know, residents, what are we going to see in terms of benefits? I think at the end of the day, when we see something like a smart grid, we want to know, you know, are we actually saving dollars and cents, and what actually will those figures look like? So what can we see as, you know, homeowners and business owners?
Yeah, there's some really interesting things here. So the first one I'd like to talk about is distribution automation. Traditionally, if there was a power outage, your crew would have to go and manually locate what the source of that power outage was. You know, was it a tree? Was it an animal? You know, was there some issue with the transformer? You know, this would take time. You know, they'd have to go street by street, try to locate and find, figure out the size of the outage. And then they'd have to manually reroute power, manually repair it. And this could take hours, sometimes even days. I mean, we've seen that, you know, in the southeast United States. What the smart grid can do, you know, when used properly, is automatically reroute the power and also find where that outage is precisely. So it saves a lot of time for crews who can fix it, and it'll automatically restore power. Now, you know, maybe, you know, during a power outage, you know, you're boiling some tea and you can't do that anymore. But, you know, you got to think about, you know, hospitals, data centers, you know, all these essential services, you know, even your streetlights, right? You know, outages can be extremely dangerous and interruptive. The second one is voltage VAR optimization. Now, this one's a little bit technical, but basically there are certain utilities, you know, appliances in your household that use more energy than they actually need. They have to they have to create an electromagnetic field, pardon me, to generate electricity. And this causes some energy inefficiencies. There are ways to regulate that, to minimize it on the grid. But this process using the, you know, the live metering, you know, that every household has, the utility can see the energy usage of every household and, you know, calibrate it in such a way that you're going to be using less electricity to power your certain appliances. So this actually will result in some savings down the road. It'll affect larger utilities and larger energy consumers a little bit more. But as we see a more electric society, you know, where, you know, even your fridge has a computer, you know, you're going to be charging your car in your storage unit. You know, this can, even the small percentage, you know, 2.7% is what they're estimating in their total savings across the grid for energy consumption. This is saving $2 million a year and something like 2,800 tons of carbon emissions per year. So it really does realize pretty major savings when applied.
I want to talk about a little bit about that. You say the project is hoping to be wrapped up by the end of next year. Was there any opposition to the project, or was it pretty much smooth sailing?
Certainly. So there were certain interveners on the Ontario Energy Board's decision, one of them being the Vulnerable Energy Consumers of Canada. They feel as though the project maybe a little bit too ambitious in terms of how it's, you know, planning to time it and deliver it. And within that year, they'd rather see a phased approach, but they're taking this faster approach to secure Natural Resources Canada funding, about $11 million. And they see this, you know, to secure that money, they have to operate within a certain time frame, and that is going to, they feel the utility save the money in the long run, as opposed to applying this over a 10-year period.
Now we have about 30 seconds left. I do want to know, you know, this project is just getting underway. Is there anything to be learned from this smart grid project that can be applied elsewhere?
It's very interesting. There's a dual need for utilities to, on one hand, be innovative and try to save energy. You know, they deal with huge amounts of power and there's huge savings that can be realized there, you know, to reduce our emissions. However, utilities are also an essential service. You know, a jump in your utility bill can, you know, drive you out your home. It can shut down your business. So there are these very serious considerations and two very opposing forces here that have to be considered. But as these technologies have become more advanced, they become more technically sound, you know, I think we're going to see this applied across the country. And Sault Ste. Marie has certainly taken a pretty big step forward here in this new utility project.
Some really interesting stuff. Thank you so much for this, Nick.
The Agenda with Steve Paikin is made possible through generous philanthropic contributions from viewers like you. Thank you for supporting TVO's journalism.